only other time that Kay Sage and Yves Tanguy's work has ever been shown together was at the Wadsworth Athenaeum in Hartford, Connecticut in 1954. What's unique about this show, however, is that in 1954, their work was kept entirely separate. It was shown in separate galleries. It was like two one-person shows.
There are a number of paintings throughout the exhibition that work on two levels. One is the aesthetic level and the other is the biographical level, because they're actually things that are communicated in the paintings that relate to the artist's biographies. Now, it's well known that the first painting by Tanguy that Kay Sage ever saw was called I Am Waiting For You. And she didn't know then how prophetic those words would be, but as you will see when you go through the exhibition, they were turned out to be the first rather strange-looking K-Sage painting. No one's ever been able to make head or tail of it because it's so different from her subsequent architectural imagery. The result we happily can say now in this for this exhibition that the reason it looks like a carved stone with incised lines is because she was inspired by the sculptures of Heinz Hengist, with whom she had this exhibition in Milan. Some of the painted pictures that early on, besides Hengist's influence, the pictures such as this one from 1937, you know, there's some forms in it that looked like forms from Yves Tanguy's paintings. A third artist who was influential to both Tanguy and Kay Sage in their work was Giorgio de Chirico.
She exhibited at the Salon des Soins de Pendants in 1938. And it was there that Tanguy first encountered her work. Probably he'd gone there, we think, at the suggestion of Hengist.
He had seen Hengist in London at Peggy Guggenheim's gallery during the summer of 38. And Hengist, it was prearranged that Hengist would, who knew the Surrealists, would be helpful, would make sure that they saw her work.
Yeah.
And so when she had a show at the Salon des Pendants, Tanguy made sure that Hengist made sure that Tanguy went to the show.
So we actually have the very first work here in this case that Tanguy made for Sage. It's inscribed on the back to her from 1938. So this is the very first work that kind of physically links the two of them together. Sage had arranged for a way to help bring her friends to America by organizing a series of exhibitions. And Tanguy, of course, was her first exhibition. By that point, they'd fallen in love. And so Tanguy came to America in November 1939, and he actually never returned to France. World War II scattered the Surrealists across the globe, really. A lot of them came to New York. Tanguy, in 1940, went out west and were married. And these are their two wedding presents to each other, the top work by Tanguy for Sage and the bottom one by Sage for Tanguy. So we had these three very, very personal works that linked the two of them together early in the show.
Something that's kind of a recent discovery that is revealed here for the first time is that the last is this painting. And what makes it so special is that it was originally part of a larger picture here, which you'll see in the wall label. Painting called If It Were 1939 by Tanguy, which was, this painting was the last picture he painted before he left France in November of 39. And when he got to America and had his exhibition at the Pierre Matisse Gallery in December of 39, at some point thereafter, he looked at this painting and decided to cut off the right portion of it and made this smaller painting from it. And this picture has the title of Outre-mer, which means overseas. And so quite literally, he was now overseas. He was in a new country, a new marriage, a new language. And the main, and this picture demonstrates.
You can see it in a picture like this one, called At the Appointed Time from 1942, where that incised stone has kind of been transformed into this kind of veined, pod-like form here. And set upon this, you know, here you can see her kind of working her way back into an architectural setting that's blended with a more naturalistic one. But this was incredibly influential for Tanguy, and it hasn't really been discussed much until now. Previously in Tanguy's work, you can see a couple of earlier examples from the 30s, he painted biomorphic forms, but they're very small and kind of scattered throughout the canvas, and there wasn't one or two that really dominated the composition. But you can see by the early 40s that Tanguy too had begun to move his forms forward in space, to increase their scale, and to really focus in on one or two that would really dominate the composition in a way that was similar to what Sager is doing with her work. So here you can see kind of the way that one artist started to influence the other.
Lost Record, it shows the transition from still including some naturalistic, recognizable imagery from nature, such as tree and water, to bimorphic forms that Tanguy had always used. So there's a transition at the Margin of Silence, 1942. She's experimenting, but something that is, as John pointed out, very consistent, is that there's always in her work forms that come forward, that connect our space with the space of the pain. And that is a consistent characteristic.
It's small in scale, it's a very important painting for Sage. Timeless Midnight Street was done in 1944. And this, Stephen has, I think, convincingly argued, was an important transitional painting for Sage in that it's the first painting in which she started to develop what became her signature scaffolding imagery.
As Jonathan said, the scaffolding form you see in the back here is really the first occasion where the scaffolding appears as an entity unto itself in her work. And there is architectural elements in earlier pictures, but nothing that has the integrity of this particular image. And what happened was, in which she was living in Italy with her first husband around 1930, she was awakened in the middle of the night because she was convinced that the scaffolding was on a building on the opposite side of the street had caught on fire. And she ran to the window and opened it, and the scaffolding was intact, and the street was quiet. She went back to sleep, and then the same thing happened again and several times. And this, she was a rather, although a very sophisticated person, nevertheless she had an interest she was superstitious. And she later learned the same occurrence had happened to an abbot in the 16th century in France. And so this was a poltergeist happening for her. And when she got to Connecticut in the 40s, it stayed with her. And she would tell her friends about this experience she had had in Italy. And because the painting's called Midnight Street, and it's nocturnal, and it has the scaffolding, I mean, it's a matter of connecting the dots. I think it's not far-fetched to say that she was thinking of her Italian dream when she was painting it.
Now, having just talked about Midnight Street, we were thrilled to be able to add this painting to the exhibition, which was recently given to the Guggenheim, and it shows, I think, just how much of an echo there can be between their work. On one hand, there are a lot of differences. Sage's is a nocturne, Tanguy's is clearly not. In Sage's, the form on the left is much larger, and the one on the right is smaller and in the distance, whereas with Tanguy's, they're both parallel with the picture plane. But I think you can see kind of the echoes. Tanguy's was done a year later, and I think you can get a sense that on the left of hers and on the left of his are both of their own forms of biomorphic forms, these kind of naturalistic, abstractive forms. And then, of course, we have Sage's scaffolding on the right-hand side of hers. And this for Tanguy is one of the most and earliest ways in which he's starting to explore a more geometric vein, and I think the impact of Sage's work on his really starts to become evident, at least in this way here.
The two paintings here, one Tanguy in one case, Sage, 1948 and 1949, compositionally, they almost form brackets, you see. This form is curved, and there are little subtle ways that they communicate with each other. I think it's even a better example here. The geometric triangular form here in Tanguy from 1948, and Case Age's clearly pyramid forms here from 47. She did it first in 47, they turned up here in Tanguy's in 48.
Kind of unique palette that Sage seemed to use so often in her work. And it's something I think as Tanguy's career moved on, and the longer that he spent with her, you can really see her palette starting to influence his work as well. Hers is very often these kind of very quiet grays and pale blues, and every once in a while a hint of orange or red as we see here, but they're very kind of almost grisaille paintings in a lot of cases. And Tanguy's earlier works were often very colorful. He's known for his jewel-like color in the 30s and early 40s. But you can see him starting to kind of pull away from that a little bit as the 40s were on, and we get into the early 50s. Painting like this, The Hunted Sky. Many of the forms are done almost entirely in shades of gray, with just the blue of the sky in the background. Or even this painting here called Because. You see little touches of orange, but not much color beyond that. And even in Tanguy's final masterpiece here, Multiplication of the Arcs, he's worked in little bursts of color, but it's overall a rather monochromatic painting as well. We have this group here of five paintings that shows kind of the interplay of a couple of different things. And one of them is Sage's interest in the late, in 1949, in these kind of bounded or domed, dome-like forms. This one's from 1949, where the scaffolding forms a dome, the fabric that's been perhaps pulled away or is being erected. And then this one where it's the dome-like shape is more of a mountain that's kind of, the exterior's been peeled aside to show that it's not a naturalistic mountain, but rather a constructed one, with all sorts of bits of fabric and scaffolding on the inside. Or even here in Sage's small portrait from around 1950, where she's taken that approach and used it for the human face, where it's been replaced or kind of peeled away to show a scaffolding within. And I think you can see echoes of that in Tanguy's work from the period, Hunted Sky from 1951, with these two kind of head-like forms in the foreground, echoing from Sage's work a year earlier.
55, Tanguy died suddenly of a cerebral hemorrhage. This was a painting called Multiplication of the Arcs. It was something that he completed in time for their 1954 Wadsworth Athenaeum exhibition a few months before he died. And it's often regarded as a summation of his life's work. After he died, Kay Sage had trouble with cataracts, with her vision, and even lost sight completely in one eye, had two cataract operations, and decided quite clearly in notes that she kept that she could not live without Tanguy, that she could not go on if she could not paint properly, and so she was going to commit suicide. But before she did that, she modeled some of her very late paintings on some of the late paintings of Tanguy. So there was a connection between them. The answer is no. Was her last painting in oil in 1958 before she decided she could not paint in oil any longer. And the way the forms in the back fill the horizon, or actually create the horizon, there's almost like unpainted canvases, paintings that she would never paint, and on easels that she must have had Tanguy's Multiplication of the Arcs, where his forms coalesce on the horizon line in mind. The picture on that side is called A Bird in the Room, and again, in keeping with their interest or their belief in superstition, it so happened that in Italy, there's a superstition that says that if a bird gets in the house, it means a fatality is near. And a few days before Tanguy died, a wild bird did get into their house in Woodbury. So that after he died, the first painting she did after he died, which is this one, is called A Bird in the Room. And finally, because she could not see to paint in oil or canvas any longer, she tried her hand at making collages. She made eight rock collages, you might call them. Now the forms, of course, they are identifiable as rocks, perhaps, but they echo some of Tanguy's shapes.
Thank you all.